This is the first panel that we will have for you, and the title is Extreme Measures or a Measured Response. The subtitle, which I don't think is in the program, is The Law, Policy, and Morality, Debate Over the Human Rights of Suspected Terrorists. So I think this flows quite nicely from Alberto Mora's discussion. We'll want to be thinking about issues like prolonged detention, issues such as enhanced interrogation, even things like drone strikes. And in that context, what are the ways in which law, policy, and morality play into the debate? We are very fortunate to have three speakers this morning for us. We're going to first hear from Dr. Peter Berkowitz, who is the Tad and Diane Taub Senior Fellow at the Hoover Institution, Stanford University. At Hoover, he chairs the Gene Perkins Task Force on National Security and Law, and he co-chairs the Boyd and Jill Smith Task Force on Virtues of a Free Society. The plan is for Dr. Berkowitz to set the table for us, basically, in this conversation. He's going to be arguing that measured responses to terror under law, which on occasion might involve extreme measures, may and often must involve moral, political, and philosophical analysis. Our second speaker will be Professor Dino Chrisiatis. He's the chair of public international law at the University of Nottingham, where he has taught since 1994, and where he serves as the founding head of the International Humanitarian Law Unit of the Human Rights Law Center. He is going to take us a little bit deeper into the law aspect of the topic, discussing the idea of applying laws of armed conflict, sometimes referred to as the jus in bello, in the context of the fight against terrorism. He's going to talk about what motivates that idea of applying the law. He's going to ask questions about the consequences of applying such an idea and the application of this jus in bello, law during the armed conflict, to the application of the jus ad bellum, meaning the law about when it is you can resort to the use of force. And so the concern in his presentation is going to be the overarching legal framework or frameworks applicable or potentially applicable in the context of terror. Our third speaker will be Professor Mary Ellen O'Connell. She's the Robert and Marion Short Professor of Law and Research Professor of International Dispute Resolution, Kroc Institute at the University of Notre Dame. All of them have information in the bios beyond what I've just said. I'll just correct one thing in Professor O'Connell's bio. She worked at Covington and Burling in 1985 to 1989, not more recently as indicated in the bio. She is going to be digging still deeper into the issue of the law in this area, and in particular, focusing on whether the lawful resort to the use of armed measures by any actor must always, in the first instance, be cognizant of and comply with the human right to life. And I think in that context, she'll be talking about how there are certain norms of international law that are regarded as jus cogens, meaning fundamental norms from which there may be no derogation. And in that context, many regard a state's obligation not to arbitrarily deprive a person of life as a jus cogens norm, and also the rules set forth in the UN Charter about the use of force as being jus cogens, and she'll be thinking about the way in which that fact may in fact have implications on a state practice in this area. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Dr. Berkowitz to come to the podium. We'll have three presentations, and then we'll do a bit of Q&A.
I too want to begin first by thanking Sean Murphy and GW and the American Friends of Hebrew University for the opportunity. In a way, I take up where our distinguished previous speaker left off, but from a higher altitude. I want to remind you of a few of the fundamental questions about law on terrorism that emerged in the United States in the wake of the September 11th attacks. However inhumanely they may have been alleged to have acted, suspected terrorists do not cease to be human beings, nor do actual terrorists. Heinous acts of mayhem and murder cannot cause their perpetrators to lose their human rights. Like the natural rights from which they descend, human rights are inalienable. But like natural rights, human rights are not absolute, and that is for two straightforward reasons. First, human rights are multiple, and they regularly come into conflict with one another: speech and privacy, criminal justice and public security, private property and state provision of basic goods and services. Sometimes one must take precedence, sometimes another. Conflicting rights must be balanced and weighed. Accommodations must be sought and achieved. Second, human rights, which are abstract prohibitions and promises, must be translated into practice. When refracted through the dense medium of human circumstances, rights inevitably lose some of their edge and gain layers of ambiguity. Consequently, determining what human rights require in any given situation depends on a knowledge of the full range of rights and a complex empirical historical inquiry. What the Bush administration called the war on terrorism, what the Obama administration calls the struggle against violent extremism, what might be better called the battle against Islamism, has given rise to a controversy over how far liberal and democratic authorities may go in using force to obtain information from enemy combatants, particularly unlawful enemy combatants. It's a legitimate controversy that raises hard questions of morals, politics, and law. There's less controversy concerning lawful enemy combatants. The Geneva Conventions and other international agreements govern the treatment of POWs, that is, those detained, who fight consistent with the international laws of war. But what about those who fight in violation of the international laws of war? What about those who do not carry their arms openly, who do not wear uniforms, who do not belong to a state's military force, who attack civilians and civilian infrastructure, and who undertake military operations from within civilian areas? What protections do the international laws of war and justice, which are not necessarily identical, guarantee? This question was urgently raised in the United States in the years following the September 11th attacks, when it became known that the Bush administration sought and gained executive branch legal authority to use highly coercive interrogation techniques on detainees held at Guantanamo Bay, at the Guantanamo Bay military base. The best treatment I know of that controversy is actually contained in a 2011 book, Because It's Wrong: Torture, Privacy, and Presidential Power in the Age of Terror. I want to make a few remarks drawing on that book. The book, Because It Was Wrong, was actually interestingly co-authored. One of the co-authors was Charles Fried, distinguished lawyer and legal theorist at Harvard University. The other co-author was Gregory Fried, son of Charles, who is at the philosophy department at Suffolk University. Interestingly as well, the father voted for George W. Bush in 2000 and supported the war in Iraq. The son opposed Bush and only reluctantly backed the Iraq war. It makes for a kind of dialectical presentation of a complex issue. The Fried's central contention is that torture is absolutely wrong. They assert, moreover, that the Bush administration broke domestic and international law prohibiting torture. The two Frieds diverged on what to do about the Bush administration officials implicated in the use of harsh interrogation techniques. The younger Fried argued that the Bush administration officials should be prosecuted to the full extent of the law. The older Fried believed that the extraordinary circumstances under which the Bush administration acted mitigated the conduct. He argued America's adversaries were religious extremists who had chosen terror as their tactic and were determinedly seeking weapons of mass destruction to kill vast numbers of American citizens and inflict a crippling blow on the United States. Also compelling forbearance, argued the older Fried, was the need in a democracy. for winners of elections to refrain from using their power to pursue their defeated rivals. The Freeds recognized that the Bush administration authorization of harsh interrogation of enemy combatants sprang from legitimate concerns. Intelligence, they emphasize, while critical in all military operations, is even more so in the struggle against terrorists. This is because, I quote here, governments know so little about where the enemy is or even who he is. The demand for intelligence against jihadists is more critical still. The language, history, culture, politics, religion, and grievances and goals of those who attacked the United States on September 11th were virtually unknown in the United States in 2001. Sad to say, despite America's long struggle, now decades-long struggle against the jihadists, we've not improved nearly enough our understanding of these matters. The Freeds deplore what they call, one a lawyer, one a philosopher, deplore what they call the weirdly legal terms in which much of the post-9/11 interrogation policy was conducted. Torture, they state, raises basic human questions. These questions concern our rights and responsibilities as citizens and as human beings. Prominent among these questions is whether, quote, our leaders are bound by the same rules as the rest of us, or rather, are our leaders, because they are responsible for the rest of us, permitted to do things and order things to be done that the rest of us must not? The answer to these questions depends on an inquiry that is at once moral, political, strategic, and philosophical. As I mentioned, the Freeds take a very hard line against coercive interrogation. In their view, coercive interrogation is not merely intrinsically bad. They contend that it is absolutely wrong, everywhere, always, and no matter what the circumstances, for the state to use violence to obtain information. It is wrong even when the police have good reason to believe that a criminal suspect has information that could lead to saving the life of an innocent child. Indeed, the Freeds go this far. They say that the use of violence in interrogation cannot be justified even in ticking time bomb scenarios, situations in which time is of the essence and the terrorist may possess information that might save tens or even hundreds of thousands of lives. The Freeds respect but reject Professor Alan Dershowitz's sober view. Dershowitz argued that in extreme circumstances, ticking time bomb scenario, when officials conclude that the balance of considerations favors using torture, officials should be able to go to a court to get permission. The Freeds share Judge Richard Posner's opinion that since the use of courts would routinize torture and implicate the whole system in an immoral act, torture should remain illegal. But the Freeds also reject Posner's pragmatic proposal. Posner argued that since torture may nevertheless be necessary in certain extreme circumstances, officials who order it should be prepared to face the legal consequences. But if extreme circumstances do in fact warrant the use of violence in interrogation, suggests Posner, judges should be prepared to show leniency, understand torture as a kind of act of civil disobedience in extreme circumstances. The Freeds, of course, understand that law is inevitably coercive, and they know that war, which by its very nature is brutal, can be necessary and lawful. But torture, in their view, is different. Torture is designed to elicit information or punish by inflicting acute physical and mental pain to destroy the prisoner's will. Ultimately, they ground their opposition to torture in, and this is their language, the sacred character of every individual life. According to the Freeds, torture is absolutely wrong because human beings are created in the image of God, and torture desecrates the divine image in man. That human beings are created in God's image signifies for the Freeds that in all human beings there's something, I quote, of a value and significance than which nothing is greater. What they seem to mean, notwithstanding the religious language, is more or less what is intended when people say that torture violates human rights. The Freeds assert that, I quote, nothing is lost in the logic of our argument, though perhaps something of its force, if we substitute the humanist for the religious conception of the sacredness, subject to further discussion. Even on these grounds, though, what justifies an absolute prohibition of torture? The Freeds accept that it is just to kill in self-defense, both for individuals threatened by criminals and for nations repelling enemies. And they know, the Freeds know, that under the laws of war doctrine of proportionality, while innocent civilians must not be targeted, soldiers may, in the pursuit of legitimate military objectives, incidentally injure or kill civilians without committing a crime, provided their use of force was not excessive. Why then, if the information gained might save hundreds of thousands or hundreds or even tens of innocent lives, shouldn't an enemy combatant in extreme circumstances be harshly interrogated? Doesn't the absolute prohibition on coercive interrogation presuppose a claim to absolute knowledge? Isn't placing an absolute prohibition on the use of violence in interrogations, declaring it not just morally and legally wrong, but absolutely forbidden under all conceivable circumstances, itself tantamount to plain God? The Freeds reply, the torture is absolutely wrong, not merely because of the pain and humiliation inflicted on the victim, but because torture degrades the torturer. To commit torture, I quote, is to become the agent of ultimate evil, no matter how great the evil we hope to avert by what we do. Freeds may well be right that torture degrades the torturer, but still that's not decisive. Might it not be an act of selfishness, in some cases monstrous selfishness, for a public official to permit 100,000 innocents to die terrible deaths, or sometimes to permit even one innocent to perish, in order to keep his or her own hands clean, his or her own conscience clear, his or her soul pure? The exercise of power in emergency circumstances in ways that violate the law as written has been a recurring feature of American political life. For example, in 1807, President Thomas Jefferson, on his own authority, spent money to fortify U.S. naval vessels against British attacks, even though Article 1, Section 9, Clause 7 of the Constitution makes clear that funds from the Treasury must be appropriated by Congress. In 1861, at the outbreak of the Civil War, President Abraham Lincoln unlawfully suspended the writ of habeas corpus, imprisoning between 10,000 and 15,000 Maryland citizens without due process of law. Woodrow Wilson signed into law the Sedition Act of 1918, which criminalized a broad range of speech that criticized the war effort. Some violations were justified, some not so. Even, I should add, when the Supreme Court ruled against it in 2004 in Hamdi v. Rumsfeld and Rasul v. Bush, and in 2006 in Hamdan v. Rumsfeld, the Bush administration, notwithstanding the wars it was waging on two fronts, did not hesitate to comply with the court's ruling. This was unprecedented on the part of the Supreme Court to intervene in the midst of war, and therefore also unprecedented for the president to comply. Some executive actions in emergency circumstances can be reconciled with respect for the law on the basis of what Aristotle called equity, or adapting justice to fit the circumstances. Some of these actions can be justified on the basis of what John Locke called prerogative, that is, the correction of the law when it fails to accomplish its purpose by completing or even acting against it in the short term to advance its long-term purpose. The need for practical wisdom to correct the inherent limitations of law is an age-old, indeed a permanent feature of the law. The Freeds feel its power. I remark in conclusion. The Freeds exhibit a certain anxiety about the moral and political implications of an absolute prohibition on torture, the one they defend. They disapprove explicitly of the distinctive combination of good humor and cold-bloodedness with which Machiavellian the Prince advises rulers, I quote, to learn how not to be good by using goodness or conventional morality according to the dictates of necessity. And yet the Freeds can't help but recognize that the Florentine had a point. Given the opaque world populated by flawed human beings in which we dwell, they who argued for an absolute prohibition, conclude that political responsibility of necessity brings dirty hands, tragic choices, and a sadder but wiser prudence. The Freeds even permit themselves the daunting thought, at odds with their conclusion that torture is absolutely wrong and an ultimate evil, that, I quote, the most costly kind of moral heroism may be a political leader's, quote, ultimate responsibility to be prepared to lose even his soul in a cause that all can understand. This seems to acknowledge that even the firmest and finest principles cannot effectively be absolutely applied. I conclude, recognizing that suspected terrorists do not lose their human rights does not solve the problem of coercive, even harshly coercive interrogation. The recognition of their human rights, rather, is the point of departure for grappling with the problem. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sean, and thank you to the George Washington University and to the American Friends of Hebrew University for this very exciting invitation. I'm particularly grateful that when the invitation came into my inbox, it didn't mention anything about Brexit, which seems to be occupying much of my gray matter over the past 3 months or so, even though it's not a speciality of mine. President François Hollande of France addresses the French nation from the Élysée Palace soon after the triple assault in Paris on November the 13th, 2015. It is an act of war that was committed by a terrorist army, a jihadist army, against France. There is no mistaking his tone or his message. It is an act of war that was prepared, organized, and planned from abroad with complicity from the inside, which the investigations will help establish, he said. In this, there is an assured and immediate sense of deja vu. We know we have been here some time before. President Bush informs the joint session of Congress a mere 9 days after 9/11 that the enemies of freedom have committed an act of war against our country, an event for which there is some historical equation, some conceptual metric. Americans have known wars, he went on to say, but for the past 136 years, there have been wars on foreign soil, except for one Sunday in 1941. There are two striking observations that seem to me to come forward from these pronouncements, set as they are 14 years apart from one another. The first must be the question regarding the essential relation between war and terror. For it is not clear whether all acts of terror constitute acts of war, or why, with the ritual uncertainties of all the violence that is involved, war itself is not regarded as an instance of terror, terror in some other guise or manifestation. Reading through the Geneva Conventions and their additional protocols, it appears that terror and all of its linguistic derivatives, terrorism, terrorist, etc., do not appear with any abiding frequency. And what spare evidence there is of these terms put to use, such as the injunction contained in Article 33 of the Fourth Geneva Convention on collective penalties and all measures of intimidation or of terrorism, and Article 51 of the First Additional Protocol on acts or threats of violence, the primary purpose of which is to spread terror, suggests that international law has in fact developed a discreet, if not explicit, coda, a certain consciousness, if you will, in which war and terror are very much distinct and separately identifiable entities. One does not necessarily intimate or entail the other. The second observation invites us to probe the significance in law of deeming terror an act of war. What does this actually mean from the standpoint of international law? What consequences flow from this? What is interesting with both of these statements from President Hollande and President Bush is how they invoke the notion of an act of war as an initiator of the legal condition of war, a rupture from the state of peace and the laws of peace, so that, presumably, the laws of war become applicable. This seems to accord with the function of the notion of an act of war historically, a period in which international law, when states more commonly declared themselves to be in a formal state of war, as compared with the more recent practices, where the term describes all military operations once the parties are in, that is, during an armed conflict. Critically, it seems to me to be important to thus ask after the consequences of the creation of a state of war. Through an act of war in this way, given the imperative of the so-called principle of equal application in the laws of war, which advises that the laws of war apply equally to all belligerent parties, irrespective of the question of how the war began or the relative justice of the causes involved. If a state of war indeed has come into being by each of these events that opened these remarks, then the principle of equal application dictates that a war exists for both sides. And this is important because we tend to view the laws of war as essentially prohibitive in nature, when in truth, they are also very much and at the same time empowering law. That is, they empower or entitle belligerents to kill, amongst other things, as part of the condition of war. As David Cole has observed in a recent essay for the New York Review of Books, the power to kill the enemy in an armed conflict is as old as war itself. Is the idea here, then, that the act of war creates the condition of war for both sets of belligerents? Or are we being presented with the unique phenomenon of a monodimensional war, where international law accepts the existence of war, but allocates so-called belligerent rights and entitlements to one of the parties and one of the parties alone? For some of you in the room, particularly the international lawyers, these opening remarks might have already affected deep sensitivities by the constant references I have made to war and to the laws of war, when, truth be told, neither of these incantations properly betrays the major conceptual revolution that occurred at the very heart of the Geneva Conventions in August of 1949, a revolution that witnessed a fundamental shift away from the language of war to the more encompassing term of armed conflict. Indeed, even this crude stylization of mine, this depiction of war versus armed conflict, is not quite right, because the conventions categorically do not institutionalize a generic concept of armed conflict. Rather, they speak much more specifically in terms of an armed conflict on the one hand, which may arise between two or more high contracting parties, common Article 2, an international armed conflict, that is, as opposed to an armed conflict not of an international character occurring in the territory of one of the high contracting parties, or non-international armed conflict, the subject of common Article 3. The distinction is rather important for two very key reasons. The Geneva Conventions, the additional protocols, and also customary international law develop these concepts of international and non-international armed conflicts as independent legal terms of art with no point of definitional coincidence between them. We do not proceed, as I heard a leading international law professor profess in public recently, they shall remain anonymous, by asking the trigger question in two stages, of whether there exists an armed conflict in Syria, and if so, by then moving to ask whether the armed conflict is international or non-international in its orientation. The verdict of the appeals chamber in the ICTY's decision in the Tadic case in October 1995 was instrumental in jettisoning this approach, even though on that occasion, the chamber did muddle matters somewhat by giving the impression that it was engaged in defining a generic term of armed conflict in paragraph 70 of its judgment. However, closer contact with the formulations of the chamber reveals that it was very much pressing into service separate propositions of law with separate substantive identities. An international armed conflict arises whenever there is a resort to armed force between states versus a non-international armed conflict of protracted armed violence between governmental authorities and organized armed groups, or between such groups within a state. The specification of the quantum of violence in each case, whenever for international armed conflicts, protracted for non-international armed conflicts, is proof positive, in my view, of this conceptual separateness upheld by the law. The second reason to make this distinction between international and non-international armed conflicts emerges, of course, from the Geneva Conventions themselves, since the applicable law is vastly different in each circumstance, at least as a matter of treaty law. For international armed conflicts, the Geneva Conventions apply as a whole, save for Common Article 3, and this is because Common Article 3 is what becomes applicable in non-international armed conflicts. It is for this reason that Common Article 3 is often referred to as a convention in miniature, and the additional protocols served to reinforce that structure when they came along in 1977, although the second additional protocol does siphon off certain non-international armed conflicts for further regulation. Of course, the normative tally is not complete without mentioning the position of customary international humanitarian law, since the overwhelming majority of rules identified by the ICRC in its groundbreaking study of March 2005, that is, 143 of the 161 rules identified, are applicable in both international and non-international armed conflicts. But even here it is the case that a determination will first need to be made as to whether or not we are dealing with one of the organizational paradigms of international or non-international armed conflicts. To my mind, this aspect of customary international law is only very rarely factored into the reckoning regarding the exercise of the classification of the conflict, and yet it speaks to the totality of laws that are or should be applicable in a given situation. So the interpretive footwork of the US Supreme Court in Hamden and Rumsfeld in June of 2006 led it to conclude that the term conflict not of an international character is used in contradistinction to a conflict between nations where international custom was invoked to eke out the meaning of what protections exist in Common Article 3. However, as one reads further into the full span of the customary law applicable in non-international armed conflicts, as itemized by the ICRC in 2005, the year before the Hamden ruling, one discovers that one of those rules is Rule 159, which talks about amnesties applicable in non-international armed conflicts. I'm sure this will become as news to the Supreme Court. And this custom apparently applies irrespective of whether or not we're dealing with a non-international armed conflict under the Geneva Convention, Common Article 3, or Additional Protocol 2. The point I'm making here is to reflect on the extent of our obsession with text and close textual comparison for conflict classification, often occurring at the expense of asking after the substance of the laws that we are seeking to apply and the structure that underpins them. In this, I do think that there is some wisdom and insight to be gained from the ruling of the Constitutional Court of South Africa in the Azapo case in July of 96, where the court found the need for the distinction between Geneva's dichotomy of international and non-international armed conflicts as obvious. It is one thing, said the court, to allow the officers of a hostile party, which has invaded a foreign state, to remain unpunished for gross violations of human rights perpetrated against others during the course of such a conflict. It is another thing to compel such punishment in circumstances where such violations have occurred in consequences of conflict between different formations within the same state in respect of the permissible political direction that is being taken. The court's emphasis on the antithesis of Geneva's laws and on the assumption belying each of these resulting concepts comes as a halting contrast to the emphasis that the US Supreme Court placed in Hamden that the scope of Common Article 3 must be read as wide as possible. The upshot of these ruminations is for us to take stock not only on the suitability in the first place of the Geneva Conventions for the humanization of any war on terror, but to also inquire as to which of Geneva's laws is actually apposite or relevant to that task. In this exercise, it might be useful to contemplate whether there is an emergence of a common international humanitarian law that should be contemplated, one that would be appended to a third category of armed conflict by virtue of custom, which can account for the legal relations between belligerents who do not really fit into the paradigm of 1949. In my view, the virtue of this approach is that it will free the existing paradigms of some of their more problematic connotations. For example, the prisoner of war regime or the belligerent occupation regime in international armed conflicts, the amnesty regime for non-international armed conflicts. And it would mean the realization of a normative corpus that for once was not fixated on specific identities or histories of the parties. Before we close, a final word ought to be uttered about the relation between the jus in bello and the jus ad bellum, or, as Sean Murphy pointed out in his opening remarks, the law that regulates the initiation of violence between states. For the normativity of 9/11, if this is what it can be called, seems to have upended these corpuses of the law and how they are meant to interact more generally. For one thing, and if I am reading the precedents correctly, it now seems possible to have an armed attack committed under the jus ad bellum in circumstances in which a non-international armed conflict is involved or being brought into being for the purpose of the jus in bello. There are also recurring suggestions that the geographies of a globalized non-international armed conflict, of the expanding compass of associated forces allied with terror organizations, are such that the operation of the jus ad bellum somehow has come to be displaced by the activation of the laws of the jus in bello and the authority to kill or detain contained therein. We need to resist these tendencies, these modalities of thinking. Any legal relationship bearing the rubric of an armed conflict does not, unless we imagine it occurring somewhere on the anonymous vastness of the high seas or in outer space, and even there are questions for international law of peaceful use, does not subsist in a factual or normative vacuum. As Harold Coe, legal advisor to the State Department, recognized when he addressed the American Society of International Law in March 2010, he spoke of the importance of all applicable law in waging the war on terror, including, we can presume, the right of self-defense and the consenting host government. Note, too, the distinction that President Obama has himself drawn between lethal force used against enemy fighter in war zones versus those who pose an imminent threat from outside the war zones. The laws of the jus ad bellum are thus in play and every inch likely to be implicated as part of the prosecution of these conflicts. Whether undertaken in terms of the right of self-defense, and I'm thinking here of Israel's hostilities against Hezbollah and the Lebanon in 2006, or the issue of state consent for drone usage in Pakistan and Yemen, or the premise of authorization from the Security Council, as some have contended with Resolution 2249 on Islamic State of last year. Evidence of this approach is on offer, too, from the practice of France, who in September of last year notified the Security Council that the activities of Islamic State constituted not only a threat to international peace and security, but also a direct and extraordinary threat to the security of France. The correspondence that France shared with the Council drew a clear distinction between force undertaken in Iraq pursuant to that government's request for assistance in prosecuting a war against the Islamic State, and the exercise of the right of self-defense in response to the attacks carried out by Islamic State from the territory of Syria, a justification that the French Foreign Minister, Laurent Fabius, returned to in November 2015 when French fighter jets struck Raqqa shortly after the attacks in Paris. Importantly, the reliance on self-defense in these circumstances of terrorist armed attacks that are over as soon as they have begun are inflicted and coupled with this idea of an extraordinary threat, does intimate to me that future claims for a right of self-defense in international law might involve the merging of these considerations into a composite argument rather than international law bifurcating anticipatory self-defense from actual self-defense, i.e. in the event of armed attack. What we see is states pushing together these two ideas into a unified argument. Quite apart from the significance that practice attaches to the simultaneity of the jus ad bellum and the jus in bello, that is, they apply at the same time, we do need to remind ourselves that the respective principles of each of these bodies of law provide separate realms for the accountability of actions taken by states, even those when those principles might look the same. So, applied as part of the jus ad bellum, the function of the principle of proportionality is to serve as a metric for the entirety of force used in a given military operation. The idea is that any authority for force does not and should not entail an authority for excessive or indeed interminable force, even though the complexities of running this kind of calculation are not problem-free. Yet viewed from the lens of the jus in bello, the principle of proportionality is designed for a micromanagement of force applied as against permissible targets in each and every given instance. These thoughts of mine are intended to recapture the vitality of the existing infrastructures of international law that I think have been forgotten in the tit-for-tat technicalities of our time. And they demonstrate to us that by returning to what the structure of the law is, we might actually be better informed as to what its substance may be. My remarks are intended to show that those infrastructures are or should be as much a part of the reckoning as the engineering or crafting of any legal argument in one direction or the other, and that it is just as important to tap into the assumptions behind the laws we seek to apply as it is to think imaginatively about a more coherent and secure modern law to meet at least some of the challenges that I've outlined in my presentation. Thank you.
I, like Dino, want to recover some of the vitality of this law by going back to first principles, going back to some of the fundamental normative underpinnings of the law that we're talking about today. I want to move out, certainly from Dino's focus on law of armed conflict in particular, to the law that controls, that should be relevant to the use of violence by anyone, government actor, non-state actor, individual. I'm going to focus especially on the international law that's relevant to the use of violence by both governments and non-state actor terrorist organizations. And that law, that international law, begins with the human right to life. The human right to life should be respected by all actors making a decision to resort to violence in pursuing any agenda. It is the violation of the human right to life by terrorists for which we so condemn them. It is to end that use of violence that we have crafted laws to guide the proper use, the use of countermeasures to such violent criminal action to respond and secure the rule of law in our world. Therefore, it's fundamentally essential, and my thesis today, that if those measures in response to lawless violence do not themselves correspond with the law, they are no better than the criminal actions they're seeking to repress in the name of the human right to life. In Peter Berkowitz's comments, he said that natural rights, he also began with human rights, which I think is the right place to begin any of these conversations. But he said that natural rights are not absolute. In fact, the right to life is absolute. That does not mean that human life may not ever be lawfully taken, but it does mean that the law permitting government authorities to use violence or force against those who would violate the human right to life do so only in certain restrictive situations consistent with the right to life. No one may be deprived of the protections promised in the right to life. The right to life itself and the conditions that it sets for the lawful taking of life are absolute. The right to life may not be suspended or derogated from, in contrast to other rights. Think of the right of assembly. In emergency situations, that may be derogated from, but not the right to life. And because we may not derogate from the right to life, UN Special Rapporteur Christoph Haines recently wrote, and correctly in my view, that this characteristic, this essential fact of the right to life, means that it is a jus cogens or peremptory norm of international law. As with other peremptory norms closely allied to the right to life, such as the prohibition of aggression and certain of the targeting rules that Dino touched on within the Jus in Bello or the international humanitarian law body, Geneva Conventions. These are all allied together and may not be derogated from. They are Jus cogens peremptory norms. But stating that fact is not enough. We have to see what the implications for the general body of law, especially international law, is with when we're talking about peremptory norms. These facts about the right to life have certain significant implications for correctly interpreting the law regulating the use of lethal force. A norm in the category of Jus cogens does not change according to the rules governing treaties and customary international law. You'll often hear law professors talk about this or that use of force has now changed the UN Charter prohibition on the use of force, expanded the right to resort in force and self-defense. That's inconsistent with the proper application and understanding of Jus cogens or peremptory norms. You will also see law professors, and I think we saw it a bit in Dino's remarks, suggesting imaginative and creative ways of rethinking the law, helping politicians stay within the law by making it more flexible for them to act. Such advice, such approaches to the law are, again, in my view, inconsistent with the higher status of the law we're talking about today. The protections inherent in these norms do not disappear when new weapons technology emerges or new forms of criminal conduct that challenge our societies. State practice that is inconsistent with the prohibitions on force or unlawful killing is always a violation of international law. Those actions do not add up to a new, more permissive, more flexible, or more creative legal right to kill. In any case of uncertainty, what the status of these norms compel is the view that we're hearing today about these blurring of the lines between war and countering crimes of terrorism. We heard about that from Dino. But the logic of Jus cogens requires adherence to peacetime law. The whole body of international law is structured to move toward eliminating war, the major violence, the most significant violence between states. The exception to this prohibition on force and the rules of international humanitarian law are designed to apply in narrowly defined emergencies only. It is the body of human rights law that normally applies as a matter of presumption. In any case of doubt, international law, the status of these norms, compels erring, making legal decisions on the side of applying peacetime law and characterizing situations as peace, including the higher restrictions on the lawful taking of human life in peacetime versus situations of armed conflict or resort to force and self-defense. The peacetime restrictions, basically the rules governing the use of firearms by law enforcement, effectively prohibit the use of military force in non-armed conflict, non-Article 51 of the UN Charter self-defense situations. Military force, including the use of missiles, drone-launched missiles, which has become the United States' common means of counterterrorism, are unlawful to use in any peacetime situation. Peacetime rules restrict the taking of life to situations of absolute necessity to save a life immediately. Missiles, bombs, other military weapons are too imprecise for use outside armed conflict zones in situations where peacetime law prevails. There is no right of the police to in any way risk the lives of bystanders. There is no collateral damage rule outside of armed conflict. That restricts and eliminates the use of weapons beyond a sharpshooter's rifle to save a life immediately. There is no margin for the battlefield collateral damage in these situations. The opinions you might have heard and seen that state otherwise overlook the fact that when you are using this level of military force outside of armed conflicts, you are violating the right to life of all involved. Attempts to justify using drones and missiles despite these restrictions on lethal force are being compelled or are incorporating ideas that it's just too difficult, given the dangers that we face, just too difficult to comply with this law, this fundamental law. But ladies and gentlemen, let me suggest to you that in fact there is nothing easier than not killing. We have in all of our communities people so morally committed to pacifism that they would never raise a hand against somebody seeking to attack them, even to protect their own life. In my home community of Northern Indiana, we live together with Amish communities that will not drive a car for fear that they might be the cause of an automobile accident that takes the life of another person. The law does not require this level of normativity and this level of restraint. It does permit the use of force in self-defense, personal self-defense by the police to save a life immediately or under the rules of the UN Charter. But what I'm saying to you is that exaggerating that we can't possibly not kill is the argument being promoted by certain foreign policy realists, certainly by weapons manufacturers, and even some academics, to advance the myth that despite the substantial social science evidence to the contrary, our societies need to resort to unlawful use of force to counter criminal violence by terrorist organizations. They pay no attention even to that data, the overwhelming data that the effectiveness of military force in drone attacks and counterterrorism not only violates fundamental norms protecting the right to life, so therefore law and morality, but also are counterproductive, ineffective, and damage the rule of law in general that we should be seeking to uphold. This law of peace that I've just sketched out very briefly is paralleled in the rules restricting the resort to military force, the jus ad bellum, as you've heard mentioned by Dino and by Sean. This law is binding on all nations. It is very old law. In my view, it's the oldest law we have in international law. We trace all of international law to the thinking of a North African bishop named St. Augustine, known to many of you. He looked to Cicero, the Roman jurist, to Aristotle, to think about what would be appropriate within Christianity to protect one community being attacked by another community, consistently with the Christian teaching of peace and of nonviolence. Yoram Dinstein, the, of course, eminent Israeli jurist, professor, I'm sorry, not from the Hebrew University, Yuval, but from that other place. He's a graduate. Okay, so you'll claim him, Tel Aviv. In his seminal book, War, Aggression, and Self-Defense, he draws on this history of the just war doctrine for equally explaining, as I just have, where we get this law. So it is rich, normative, old. I mean, we're talking about the 5th, 6th centuries when these ideas were being developed and carried forward into today's international law. It was Aquinas, later a jurist as well as a priest and scholar, who said we've got to have basic, normative, law-like restrictions on the resort of military force by one community against another. Any resort to force, to be lawful and moral, must have a just basis, a just cause of a very limited nature. It may only be resorted to by a governmental authority with the right to do so. That authority has to pursue the use of force with the right intention based on that just cause. And any use of force must comply with the principles of necessity and proportionality. And what you haven't heard yet about necessity is that from the just war doctrine times until today, that means not only is the resort to force always mandatory as a last resort, but the assessment must be taken at the outset of the decision to resort to force that there is a high likelihood of success. And just to make the point quickly now, given that social science data, given why we fight to preserve the rule of law, violating the rule of law in resorting to military force, creating the kind of anger, dislocation, governmental breakdown that is following in Yemen, in Pakistan, in Somalia, in so many other countries where the U.S. and others have resorted unlawfully to military force, we cannot make that necessity finding where, in other words, these unlawful measures are not resulting in success. And I think Dino said enough about proportionality. You have to assess how high the cost is that you're imposing, even if you've met all the other restrictions on resort to force. Now, this law did become part of positive law. It's out of course, natural law. It's out of reason based on observations of what God, the natural world, tell us is good. And it is also based on transcendent inspiration. These strands that are taken into any assessment of understanding what natural law are followed this law that I'm talking about into certain positive law documents, certain treaties, most importantly the Kellogg-Briand Pact, which prohibited the resort to the use of force, and then even more importantly, the Kellogg-Briand Pact is brought into the United Nations Charter in 1945 with Article 2.4, a general prohibition on the use of force by states, with only two narrow express exceptions, as is appropriate for a natural law principle, such as the restrictions on the use of force. The great German-American legal theorist Hans Kelsen said soon after the UN Charter was drafted that this is the restatement, this is the current statement of the natural law just war doctrine. The UN Charter, and of course the time is running quickly, so I'm going to be very trimmed down in my, I'll just say the essential points about the UN Charter, what we know from the drafting history, the actual terms of the Charter, and the subsequent authoritative analysis by the International Court of Justice. Article 2.4 is a general prohibition. Any significant violation of Article 2.4, and that includes excessive interpretation, flexible interpretation of those two exceptions, Article 51 and Security Council authorization, will violate jus cogens. This is an act of aggression that will violate jus cogens. The first person to, as far as I can tell, to actually state in a authoritative text that a significant violation of Article 2.4, aggression, is a violation of jus cogens was, again, Louis Henkin, who you heard Alberto Moro quote earlier. He was my teacher. He was Sean Murphy's teacher. And Louis Henkin states in the Restatement Third of Foreign Relations Law that the violation of Article 2.4 would be a violation of the jus cogens norms. So that restricts how widely we can read any of the exceptions. Exceptions are always to be narrowly construed anyway, because exceptions should never sink the general rule. In this case, the most popular exception is Article 51, the use of force in self-defense. It does say that the use of force in self-defense in the UN Charter is an inherent right, yes, but without pause or hesitation, it says in response to an armed attack. And we know from the International Court of Justice that, and the logic of Jus Cogens, it must be a significant attack. And the attack must be attributable to a sovereign state if you're carrying out military force on that sovereign state's territory. It must conform with general principles of law, not in the Charter, but part now of international law through the natural law methodology, necessity, and proportionality. All these restrictions keep Article 51 consistent with the logic of Jus Cogens. I hope that we might have a chance during the Q&A to discuss some of the cases that in which the United States, using drones, has plainly violated this law. Sean's already given me the signal. So let me just then conclude that measures of counterterrorism must follow international law when they're being used abroad to be worthy of rule of law nations. We must distinguish lawful counterterrorism from criminal acts of opponents. We have to do that to be effective, and more importantly, to be moral. I would compare what we're doing today in many of our countries, the use of this so-called targeted killing in clear violation of the human right to life, whether in war or peace, to the use of torture. My husband was a United States Army interrogator. He was a highly decorated hero of the Gulf War. It was due to his effective, lawful, moral interrogation that we were able to win that war, a coalition of countries fighting in defense of the UN Charter and the Article 51 rule on self-defense. We won that war in 100 hours of combat. We were able to be successful because we followed the rule of law. And I know that from firsthand on the battlefront commentary. So that's what I'm urging today, and I'm sorry for having gone over time.
Well, thank you very much, Marianne and Dino and Peter, for wonderful presentations. I hope it has sparked a bit of thinking in the audience, and we only have about 10 minutes before we want to move on to the next panel on compensation for victims. But I think what I'll do is take two or three questions together and then let the panelists respond. So let's start right here with Ike himself. You'll need a microphone, I think. Does anyone else have a question they want to raise their hand and get our attention on it? The mic's coming. Is there one in the back there? So you'll be our second question. And
you.
He'll get a chance. We've got a second question in the back and a third question there. Because those will be the three for the time being.
Yeah. I've got two pieces to it. Number one, you all talk in terms of human rights. Isn't there an argument to be made, and I'll pick Jihadi John, the man who entertained us by cutting off people's heads, that it's not the character of it's not the person as a human, it's his conduct, which would take him out of being a human being. And therefore, and I'm not suggesting my position in any way, but his conduct is inhuman and doesn't qualify him for human rights. That would be the first issue. The second is, you talk about the UN Charter, which I know virtually nothing about, the Geneva Convention, which I know nothing about, and it talked about states and war zones. We don't have war zones anymore. We don't have states. ISIS is not a state. We don't have countries, states, dealing with that issue. So it's really two parts to this. the ISIS issue as not being a state? And secondly, how does Jihadi John qualify as a human?
Great. We'll take, Franny, a second question here just off the aisle. Yep. And then we'll come over. Number three. Yep.
Two questions. One, Mary Ellen, the way I understood what you said, we should not have invaded Afghanistan because it wasn't the government of Afghanistan that created 9/11, but some people who happened to live there at that time. I wanted to know if that's correct, if I understood what you were saying. And the other thing is profiling a human right, or are we allowed to profile, you know, airports, et cetera?
So let's pass the microphone down the aisle there, or down the row, I should say. And this will be number three, and then we'll come back, and if it's okay, maybe we'll go with Peter Dino and then Mary Ellen, and you can answer as you wish. Yes, sir.
Thank you for interesting presentations. I have a question on what your analysis would be on the following historical situation. The last major conflict between Hamas and Israel, when Hamas proceeded to launch a substantially increased number of missiles into Israel. One of Israel's responses was to drop leaflets on particular buildings where Hamas combatants were hiding among civilian population, saying within the next period of time, presumably about 24 hours, give or take, we are going to bomb this building. Please evacuate. Now, in some cases, presumably the citizens, the innocents evacuated. In other instances, they were prevented from doing so, and the buildings were bombed. How would you analyze the use of force under those circumstances and the killing of innocents, and yet under those specific circumstances?
So that may be an opening to talk a little bit about this war versus law enforcement paradigm in that context, but even in other contexts as well. We could think about U.S. drone attacks in Iraq against ISIS at the consent of the government of Iraq. Which paradigm does that fall into? Saudi Arabia and Yemen? There's various possibilities. But Peter, I'll let you start responding in whatever way you wish to the three questions.
Terrific, thanks. Very briefly. Can you hear?
We're supposed to be mic'd.
Yeah.
Can you hear in the back?
Yes, I'll speak up, sorry. Very briefly on the question of Jihadi John. Well, the doctrine, our doctrine, says that you can't alienate your rights, even with inhumane, even with malicious, incomprehensible, wicked behavior. And we have the consideration that I mentioned, that the Freeds emphasize, that honoring, respecting human rights is not only about respecting the rights of individuals, our adversaries, but it's about us and maintaining the rule of law, which I think you suspect. Secondly, just quickly on the question of Hamas, we do have these major principles of international law: necessity, distinction, proportionality. But it really is possible to say about these three principles what Hillel said when he was asked whether he could explain the whole Torah standing on one foot. Do not do to others what you would not have done unto you. All the rest is commentary. Understanding the principle of necessity, how it applies in any particular circumstance, even as a last resort. Principle of distinction, distinguishing yourself from the combatants, distinguishing themselves from civilians. And fighters attempting to distinguish civilians from fighters. Tremendously complicated once you find yourself on the battlefield or planning for war. Similarly, for proportionality, tremendously complex, often, not always, but often enough in battle, tremendously complicated calculations are necessary to determine what force precisely goes up to the borderline of excessive and what goes beyond it. I'll stop there.
Great, thanks, Peter. Dino.
Thank you, yes. I mean, as an international lawyer, I think it's very important to draw a distinction between human rights
under international law, which really evolved after the Second World War, and the laws of war, which really date back to the 19th century. And I think one of the very important issues to think about when you're thinking about the laws of war is what you're actually doing is you're not empathizing with your neighbor, you're empathizing with your enemy. So in many senses, the laws of war presents us with a much more noble calling than the sort of political theory that underpins human rights. And I think whether or not you're looking at one or the other of those regimes under international law, I'm emphatically of the view that they are not rewards for good behavior. Peter, have used an excellent term about the notion of alienation. You cannot alienate the right. So I think the issue that we have to be concerned here with is, irrespective of the conduct or indeed the nature of the individual we're dealing with, humanity remains. And this is one of the critical issues that I think was lost out in the course of the Bush administration, where everyone seemed to be focused on the issue of torture. Torture, 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 torture. Torture is one of the acts prohibited by international law. But under the regime of the Geneva Conventions, it's humane treatment that is the baseline. And I think we lost immense opportunity to clarify what is the meaning of humane treatment to the detainees in Guantanamo, et cetera, et cetera. So I think if you look closely at the Geneva Conventions, it's humane treatment that seems to me to be what needs to be fleshed out. Just on the point of Hamas, historically international law said that if you were going to attack a particular target, it needed to be verified under the so-called Hague rules, draft rules of 1923. But there is a new formula in international law where you can actually bring dual-use targets. So if a particular target is both civilian and military, for example, a bridge, it's possible to make the argument that it is a lawful target. And I think that the dropping of leaflets by Israel on that particular occasion demonstrated goodwill in terms of the law on proportionality, which requires you to actually take certain precautions so that you avoid excessive human casualties.
Thank you, Dina. Mary Ellen.
Well, let me begin by saying that I think in some of our societies, we've grown to the point of thinking that military force is the answer for so many social problems, or heightened militarizing the police, resorting to force in all kinds of situations we would not have some years ago. I'm not entirely sure of the origins of that. I think it's got something to do with the points I made in my talk, realism, the Eisenhower's military-industrial complex and others, but it really sells short our criminal justice processes, which were working very effectively, really doing the right job after, in so many occasions, there are so many success examples that law enforcement, the law enforcement approach works. And maybe people undersell law enforcement because they think it's so puny compared to military force. And yet, lawfully, there's a great deal that can be done. For example, the United States sent a commando unit to the lawless, chaotic situation of Libya. They were able to detain an individual who masterminded the attacks on the Benghazi consulate, and he is now standing trial in the United States. That's a much better example to send to all of his folks out there. He doesn't become a martyr, as with Anwar al-Awlaki, the victim of a drone strike, a lawless drone strike. Seeing and applying the rule of law to an individual like that man from Libya sends the message of where this country's values are. Every day that he spends in prison shows the world that we follow the rule of law and we're not going to have our values and our principles torn down by people like terrorists who would seek to do that. That's the message that I think works, that we have to send, that this country was founded on as a rule of law nation. The comment that there are no states anymore, that maybe somehow this law doesn't work because we don't have war zones and so forth, I'm sorry, but if you look at the international law, that's simply not the case. I currently feel I'm living in a very viable sovereign state, very proud of its sovereignty and its status as a state. It's not going anywhere. But if we allow these kinds of arguments that, you know, I don't see ISIS as a state. ISIS does not meet the international law criteria of a state. Don't give it that power. Don't ignore the international law and confer a status on that group of violent, chaotic extremists, the imprimatur of statehood with all that that entails. That's what they want. This statement was made so often after 9/11. If you call al-Qaeda members combatants, you have conferred on them a status that they want. They're not combatants. They're lawless criminals. So it behooves all of us to know this international law better, understand where it came from, and why it has the rules that it has. So a particular and very short answer to the question about Afghanistan and attribution, a fundamental principle of the international law on resort to force. Of course, you've got to be, if you're invoking the exception for self-defense to the general prohibition, it has to be aimed at the party responsible for the violent armed attack, the significant armed attack that triggers the right in Article 51. Well, the Security Council told us that they were able to come together and very quickly confirm that the 9/11 attacks in this country were armed attacks that meet the Article 51 requirement. The British very helpfully came up with a white paper drawing a lines of attribution between the Taliban de facto effective government in Kabul to the acts of al-Qaeda. We now know that, all due respect, I owe most of my higher education to the British and a Marshall scholarship, so I say this with great pain. They are not unknown for cooking their books. They cooked the books on the attribution standard. They thought it was a lower standard at that time. The International Court of Justice has told us it's a higher standard. The Taliban should have been in control of al-Qaeda. But we also know subsequently from Lawrence Wright's excellent book, The Looming Tower, that in fact the Taliban were fed up with al-Qaeda. They wanted to get rid of them. They were being put in a position of an ultimatum by the Security Council to detain Osama bin Laden and send him to the United States before 9/11. They felt that pressure was inappropriate and not the proper way to negotiate a mutually satisfactory solution. It's really one of the tragedies of our time that we didn't work with the Taliban, reform Afghan society, and not pursue a 15-year war where the results today are no better than when we first invaded. I wrote at the time thinking that the British had a good case, that they were not exaggerating the attribution case, the connections between al-Qaeda and the Taliban, that in fact the resort to force and self-defense by the US and in collective self-defense by the UK did meet the UN Charter principles until the fall of Kabul. Remember, Secretary Powell said we were not going into Kabul, that this was about clearing al-Qaeda out. Mullah Omar and bin Laden were on the run. That was our war aim. And that's what we wanted to do for our self-defense. After they were on the run, however, we continued with high aerial bombardment. We have never quit. So there were multiple problems with the use of force in Afghanistan, and I'm sure President Obama says to himself almost every day, why didn't we follow the rule of law strictly and question the British far more profoundly before we unleashed forces that we're still trying to reckon with and bring back with under the rule of law to this day?
Well, this has been a very rich discussion, and I think we could probably continue it for some period of time, but we do have another panel that we want to start on time. It will begin in a couple minutes. I encourage everyone to stand up and stretch, but not to leave your seats, because we're not taking a full-blown break, but shake your legs a little bit. But before you do that, please join me in thanking our panelists for a very interesting discussion.